running right before the break. First comment was John's about, remind me what we were talking about again.
Just in conversations with Orthodox folk, they sometimes will say something that no one can really know.
No, the certainty of salvation. This is actually just so huge. Let's be clear, though. Let's not fall off the bandwagon on the other side. Lutherans do believe and teach that you can fall away from the faith, right? We do not believe once saved, always saved. So we always have warnings to our carnal self. Don't you dare go down that road. Do not presume on grace, right? But at the same time, we say to any believer, be assured of your salvation. You can be certain of this. And how do we know it? What does the Word of God teach on salvation in 1 John 5? Do you remember what it says? 1 John 5. This is your perfect anti-Orthodox passage. Memorize it. These things are written that you may know that you have eternal life. And this life is in His Son. Okay? So this is a very precious teaching. If you talk to a devout Orthodox or a devout Roman Catholic, their answer is, I hope to be saved. And I would suggest to you that in the terrors of conscience that accompany dying, I hope to be saved doesn't get you very far. You know, you need something more stable, certain, and secure than I just hope so. Okay?
So what is it in the Orthodox theology that makes them say that?
Well, the simple answer to that, which they will vehemently deny, but I still think it works out this way in the way they comfort people, is they've thrown an anthropological reference in that you cannot be certain of. So they'll say salvation is essentially something that involves synergy. And remember, synergy is not a bad term by itself. It's a term St. Paul uses. We are God's synergists, he says, right? You know? So the term by itself is not evil, but the way that the Orthodox use that term, they are saying that salvation is finally something that you, together with God, by God's grace, accomplish. Both together. And because of that, how can you ever know? They would say it would be pride for you to say you know. It's the exact same argument the Roman Catholics use. They're of a piece on that particular thing. Orthodox in general do better on emphasizing grace. But if you push comes to shove on this, and this touches on the question that was raised about Monerma and the Finnish school. How many of you guys, anybody in this book, in this room, have read the book, Union with Christ? Or, okay, so there are those who have read it. And you guys tell me if I'm being unfair. I think when I read that book, Monermas was the founder of that school, if you will, but he's the one I found to be actually least compelling. I thought Puera's argument was actually very, very well argued, very strong. Luther uses the language of theosis without thinking about it. Lutheran orthodoxy uses the language of theosis. It was in our hymns. Ben, do you remember offhand? Er wechselt mit uns von der Licht. I can't remember. We really tamed it down in English, but it says, you know, he exchanges with us in a wonderful way. He takes our human form, but he does it to give us die klare Gottheit drein. He does it to give us the luminous deity. And if you struggle with theosis, all you need to do to fix that is put the word son or child in there. Christ became a child of man to make the children of men the children of God. He becomes what you are by nature to make you be what he is by grace. This is not in itself a problem. And Luther himself in the Great Galatians commentary uses the word divinize. He does not hesitate to use that kind of language. In Great Galatians, which is, if you really recall, the book that the Formula of Concord says, any other questions you have about justification, go read Great Galatians. So if there is a writing of Luther that's implied to be in our Book of Concord that's not actually listed out there, it's Great Galatians. You got to watch your English, because the English translators hate it. The way that the divinizing language, and they tamed it down. But it's there. Luther's word was Vergötzet. To divinize, to make divine. The Lutheran approach to this, though, is exactly, I would argue, categorically opposite from the way that most of the Orthodox tend to think of it. John Kleinig's book, Grace Upon Grace, is the key. You guys, are you familiar with that? It's gold. It's gold. He says, basically, this is the process of theosis. God keeps on taking things away from you, one after the other. And every time he takes something away, he says, but you still have me, and I'm enough. And the day is going to come when he takes away your breath. And he's going to say, but you still have me, and I'm enough. And this is theosis, not this infinite climbing up, but this finding that having him really is enough. He gives himself fully to you, and if you have him, you have everything you need. And he gives himself fully to you. And the older you get, the more you get this thing about taking away, right? The sorrows mount. Otherwise, on the let me just also say real quickly, on the finished school thing, I'm going to get in hot water anyway. I dislike 40. I've never read him. But from what I read people writing on him, I dislike him and distrust him immensely. I mean, I know they make you read him in seminary and all that stuff, but he has absolutely zero place for dealing with mystical union. And in classical Lutheran thought, mystical union was huge. It's not a little thing. It's huge. That God, you know, Chemnitz says he wants to join us more and more to himself. Listen to that more and more language. If you're a 40-eyed, it will make you uncomfortable. You're like, I'm already perfect in Christ. How could he increase it? You can increase the appropriation of him in your life. You can live more and more from him and less from the old Adam. This is progress in sanctification. And anybody who tells you it doesn't exist is lying to you. So don't buy into that way of thinking, please. And I know people, we've had this great antinomian debate here in this of 2013, and people have made it, or 14, where are we in 14 now, aren't we? But they make it sound like it's, you know, a legalism. That's not, no. There really is a progress in the Christian life. The progress is living less and less from you and more from Christ. It's a grace, and it's a growing in grace. And you can grow in grace. If you don't believe you can grow in, do you get this? Roman Catholic teaching is that grace grows in you. Lutheran teaching is you grow in grace. The gift is given to you entire and whole. And then you are invited, grow in your living from it. You can do that. So, at least I got Pastor Peterson shaking his head up here in a good way. All right. Any other questions that were left over from the first time that we need to deal with? Yes?
Quick one. I was wondering, when you said you were struggling with Article 3
mm-hmm.
and the language of
reconciling.
Reconciling to mm-hmm. man rather than the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like in either case, it's a question of reconciliation.
Yes.
Which then, as you went on, the reconciliation talk in general is what was the more Anselmic view, right?
Yes.
I mean, so why did it matter for you so much which way it went with God?
Because if I could find something wrong in the Augsburg Confession, I could get out of this mess. I mean, that's why it mattered to me. It was like, okay, this is really simple. You know, look at the way Paul talks. This is not the way it works. Pastor Curtis, bless his heart, pointed out to me right away. He said, you're not thinking about the way reconciliation works. We didn't think about it in normal human relationships. And tell me, you know, bring that whole thing to the equation and look at it again. And I was like, no, you're wrong. I'm not going down that path. I'm not listening to you. And it simply is the case that Scripture can work either way with God as our enemy, who then, through Christ, is reconciled to us because his holiness is constantly opposed to anything that's not holy, and the other way, that God is the one who sends his Son into the flesh to deal with that problem so that we can be saved in him. It works both ways, and Scripture proclaims both ways. And we need to proclaim both ways, and not merely one or the other. I think that's key, too. If you're a pastor who only preaches Anselm and doesn't preach the other, that's a problem. By the way, remember I said I promised my district president I would be really good and not teach against this. So what I did was I just wouldn't teach the Anselmian way. I just did it the other way. And I proclaimed, you know, Pastor Peterson heard me do a paper on this, and he said, I preached against you for a month after that paper. I was convinced Christus Victor is the way to go. Well, you know, it's bigger in Luther than anything else, and it's bigger in the fathers than anything else. It's huge. Well, of course, the problem is you just can't wipe out the rest of the scripture way of teaching. You got to have both. And is this should be no problem for a Lutheran. So it doesn't make sense if you can't reconcile the two together. What else in our faith can you reconcile together? We've got these, you know, that's a constant thing of being a Lutheran, right? I'll get you one second, Paul. I always remember the way Dr. Nagel described how Lutherans do theology. He says, he calls it bucket theology. He says, to be a Lutheran is you take a bucket and you say grace. And then you romp through the scriptures and dump into the bucket everything that the Bible has to say about grace. And there's your doctrine of grace. You throw it out on the table and, you know, there it is. He says, and then, well, what about election? You romp through the scripture, put in everything about election. What happens if what you get in one bucket, you can't figure out how to reconcile to the other bucket?
You throw one of the buckets out.
Do you throw one of the buckets out? Or do you say, go talk to the boss. It's not my problem. This is what the Bible says about this. And this is what the Bible says about this. And I'm to teach you what the Bible says. So just because you can't make the two of them fit together in your mind, and I can't make them fit together in my mind, tough. This is the truth of God. And you hold each one out. Which, by the way, is why sometimes when you read the Fathers, you get a... St. John Chrysostom, I'm going to show you before we're done, he is one of the absolute best at faith alone. You think Luther invented the alone and faith alone? It came from John Chrysostom, provided he's talking about a scripture passage that actually is dealing with that topic. But if you get him on a scripture passage that's more about works, it's like he never even heard anything he wrote before. And he just deals with the one that's in front of him. That's actually a pretty Lutheran principle. You know, preach the text. Preach the text, the gifts that are in the text. You know, and don't worry about how to bend that text to another. Paul.
You demonstrated pretty well in quoting these fathers this morning, that they had a good, clear understanding of the atonement that mm-hmm. in some cases could even be described as ensomic.
Yes.
How would you describe those Americans who try to call themselves Eastern Orthodox today, what theory or theories of the atonement, if any, they have?
Well, Christus Victor is their picture. You know, that's clearly the way, that's what they're most comfortable with. And with Christus Victor, also, of course, the example. Christ as example. What they're most uncomfortable with is any kind of a legal transaction centering around the satisfaction of the law.
It also struck me in my reading that it's curiously unbloody.
Very
little blood in their theology.
The shedding of the blood, it... Okay, let's get at this from another way around. You only go on living because something dies. Right? You don't like to think about it. What is your refrigerator? What is it? It is a morgue. It is a place where you stow dead stuff that's in the process of rotting that you hope to stick into your body and supply you with what little life's left in the dead stuff before it finally... And everybody in this room has on that back shelf, on the third shelf in the Tupperware container that you forgot about. And you know, you don't even open it, right? You just take the whole thing and throw it in the trash because it's going to stink so bad. The life that rots, if you will. So, you only live from the death of another thing. The Orthodox get that. And so they would see what Christ does in his atonement as he's supplying us with the food that we need to have a life that never ends. The only way humans can do it by taking into themselves something that had died to give them life. So they deal with blood that way, but they don't deal with the idea that Paul would talk about the blotting out the handwriting that is against us. That's just not a real big thought for them, even though it's a scriptural thought that they wouldn't deny. It's just not real big in their consciousness. Okay, I'm going to move on if we can. We'll have more time for questions before we're done, I hope. What I am in fact then suggesting to you guys is the Lutheran Church has a gift in this understanding of justification as the consolation of conscience, which makes it worth putting up with piles of the bull Twinkie around us, but only if it is to deliver that gift. Luther describes the pure conscience like this. He says, this means that a man is not bitten by the recollection of his sins and is not disquieted by the fear of future punishment. Let me say that again. That a man is not bitten by the recollection of his sins and is not disquieted by the fear of future punishment. Further, I would suggest to you that if our preaching were to aim at the task of consoling or establishing once again pure consciences as described by Luther, we would in fact see almost all of the monkey business that troubles us recede. The joyous aha of the Reformation, it was not about how to live the blessed life. That's what the monks tried and failed. The joyous aha of the Reformation was to teach people how to die the blessed death. And once they were set free, knowing how to die the blessed death, then they really could live in freedom, in peace, in joy. So that's where the Reformation began, and I think it's where we need to return again. Further, I'd argue that in this treasure of using justification to console a troubled conscience, if it's preserved, everything else will be preserved. And if it's lost, it doesn't much matter what's preserved, it's just a shell. My friend David J. Weber, he puts it like this. He says, a lot of the other churches have institutional backups so that they look like they're still going on even if the guts are pulled out. But Lutheranism doesn't have any backups. If the pure gospel of the sinner's free forgiveness isn't at the heart, we just say the church collapses. And it doesn't matter how pretty it looks on the outside or how nice your bishop's hat is. It's still not the church. That's why Leah could say, the church remains a queen even when she's robed in beggar's rags. And he goes on to say, she doesn't need to be robed in beggar's rags, but it's better that she loses everything else and keeps the pure doctrine, by which he meant the joy of, and he was a master at this in his sermons, better than Walther, at bringing the comfort of Christ to bear on the troubled conscience. He knew how. Have any of you guys read any of his sermons? He's a little flowery. You'd like him. He's flowery. He's a poet at heart. He's a romantic. But, you know, he knew how to bring comfort. Well, Walther did too at points. God granted is probably, I think, one of the best collections of Walther's stuff. You hear him at work in it. And I know that many of you will profoundly disagree with me what I'm about to say. But when has that ever stopped me? I simply believe that the Orthodox actually have the doctrine of justification right if you push them. But they're notoriously difficult to pin down when it comes to doctrinal formulation. And they usually refer people to their Lexi Rondi, to the liturgy. They say, if you really want to get what we teach, you need to know what we pray. So I want you to listen to a prayer. You tell me what you think of it. I mean, I see some problems with it, but I also go, wow, the Orthodox say that? Remember that awful prayer I gave you before? What about this one? This is a morning prayer in the Russian tradition every day. O my plenteously merciful and all-merciful God, Lord Jesus Christ, through thy great love, thou didst come down and become incarnate so that thou mightest save all. And again, O Savior, save me by thy grace, I pray thee. For if thou should save me for my works, that would not be grace or a gift, but rather a duty. Yea, thou who art great in compassion and ineffable in mercy. He that believeth in me, thou hast said, O my Christ, shall live and never see death. If then faith in thee saveth the desperate, behold, I believe, save me, for thou art my God and creator. Let faith instead of works be imputed to me, O my God, for thou wilt find no works which could justify me. But may my faith suffice instead of all works. May it answer for, may it equip me, may it make me a partaker of thine eternal glory. And let not Satan seize me and boast, O word, that he hath torn me out of thy hand and fold. But even if I don't want it, save me, O Christ, my Savior. Forestall me quickly, quickly, for I perish. Thou art my God from my mother's womb. Vouchsafe me, O Lord, to love thee now as fervently as I once loved sin itself, and also to work for thee without idleness, diligently, as I worked before for deceptive Satan. But supremely shall I work for thee, my Lord and God Jesus Christ, all the days of my life, now and unto the ages of ages. Would you at least concede that it's a little bit better than the prayer to the Virgin? Huh? Still, we're left wondering if this is a little bit of faith in faith.
That's exactly,
you know, the way it sounds, it's like it would be nicer if it talked about the object of faith. But there's plenty of times that Luther speaks right along these same ways, and frankly, so does St. Paul in Romans at points, right? If we give them a pass and say, let's explain it in the kindest way and assume that they actually meant that here, I can grant that that when the push comes to shove, they could teach justification correctly. But so what? They haven't got the first clue on how to use it. I mean, if you have the doctrine right and you stow it on a shelf in your closet and do not pull that doctrine out in the time of need, what good does that doctrine do you? When a man hears the unyielding and unbending demands of the law, when it really sinks home that Jesus said, and you know, he always says what he means, and he means what he says, and he says, you must be perfect, for I, your Father, or as your Father in heaven is perfect. Or when he says in the Psalms, who will ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who will stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to vanity or sworn deceitfully. Well, what about the one who will dwell on his holy hill, he who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart and does not slander with his tongue and does no evil to his neighbor? Hear it. And when you hear it, by the grace of the Spirit, see the truth that whatever that is a description of, that is not a description of the way you live your life. What then? What comfort can be set before such a one that he doesn't despair, that he can face the terrors that come with death and yet make it through? Our Lutheran Church has a priceless heritage to help at that moment. And it is something, this is why, you know, all the talk about the proper distinction between law and gospel being so priceless, it's priceless at the deathbed. That's where it truly comes into its own. We can help because we bring no earthly work to bear. You know, it's the opposite. Someone's dying and they're terrified. And so what does the family say? They say, oh, it's okay. Don't worry. You've been a good person. You've been a good father. Thank you. You know, and or like my wife's uncle's funeral, it was so bad. The guy that was talking up there, it was like and one of the relatives said, I'd have liked to have known that man. Everybody knew that that wasn't the truth about him, you know? You couldn't hold anything certain there. When someone's dying, he needs something a little stronger than, well, God's merciful and I know that you've been nice, you know? You need something as certain as, if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ. He is the righteous one. He is the wiping out, the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. That is something you can absolutely hold on to, believe, and trust. It's a priceless heritage. And it's no accident, then, that the Lutheran Reformation saw this immense comfort to be located where? and be the point of what? This is another Lutheran uniqueness. The sacraments. What's the point of the sacraments? They are there to give you the rock on which you can stand against the very gates of hell. Listen to what the Lutheran confessions say. From the Apology. A conscience full of fear has need of much consolation. Baptism and the Lord's Supper are signs that continually remind, cheer, and encourage despairing minds to believe firmly that their sins are forgiven. Think about that. The sacraments are there to comfort a terrified conscience. How about this one? Large Catechism. Everything in the church, everything is ordered to this goal. We shall daily receive in the church nothing but forgiveness of sins through the word and signs, the sacraments, to comfort and encourage our consciences as long as we live here. You want to know what's screwed up in the Lutheran church? She does not order everything about her life toward the comfort of terrified consciences. If that becomes the key again, it changes everything. Again, baptism and the Lord's Supper, appointed as outward signs, work as seals, that is Luther's way of saying, as promise, guaranteed promises of forgiveness. Specifically about baptism, listen to this. We must think this way about baptism and make it profitable for ourselves. For when our sins and conscience oppress us, we strengthen ourselves and take comfort and say, nevertheless, I am baptized. And if I am baptized, it's promised me that I shall be saved and have eternal life in both body and soul. The impious doubt that masquerades as humility is absolutely opposed to the sure promise of God given you in your baptism. What about absolution? Obviously, I mean, that should just come hand in glove with this, right? Now, strictly speaking, repentance consists in these two parts. One part is contrition. How does the confession describe contrition? This is something that King Corby never ceased to emphasize to us. What is contrition? Most people hear contrition and they say, being sorry. No. What is contrition? That is terrors striking the conscience through the knowledge of sin. Contrition is not regret. Contrition is terror. Big diff. The other part is faith, which is born of the gospel, or absolution. I love that. What, by the way, what's the gospel? Oh, it's absolution. What's absolution? Oh, it's the gospel. Now, Walther liked that. And believes that for Christ's sake, sins are forgiven. It comforts the conscience and delivers from terror. So you got both going on. The law that terrifies and the gospel that consoles. And you have to have both going on constantly to keep us Christians, because the one gives you the gift of humility and the other gives you the gift of peace. And you need both in your life constantly. The people are very taught very carefully about faith and the absolution. When's the last sermon you heard about faith and the absolution? Well, maybe here you've heard a sermon or two about it. Our people are taught that they should highly prize the absolution as being God's voice and pronounced by God's command. The power of the keys is set forth in its beauty, and they're reminded by what great consolation it brings to anxious consciences, and that God requires faith to believe such absolution as a voice sounding from heaven. Wow. What about the Eucharist? How about this? Talk about an area to repent of. No one, let me say that again, no one is admitted to the sacrament without first being examined. The people also are advised about the dignity and use of this sacrament and about how it brings great consolation to anxious consciences, so that they too learn to believe God and to expect from him all that is good. This worship pleases God. I get so sick of hearing people go on and on and on about the evils of open communion when we're not even being honest about what we're doing. You know, the Catechism is blessedly ignorant of the idea of a Lutheran. It doesn't even enter in. It deals with Christians, right? And how does a Christian use the sacrament? If he has a faithful pastor, that faithful pastor says, before you come up bellying, that's quoting Corby, bellying up to the altar, we need to talk. And you find out what a person, you do not do this just on according to institution. Oh, you're a member of the Missouri Synod. Oh, welcome, come on up. What kind of stewardship of the altar is that? Right? I mean, this is not taking care of our people. This is not taking care of our visitors. We should definitely bother to ask. Oh, what was it Corby asked? Who are you? Why are you here, and what do you want? He did it at the altar. You know, and remember the guy that said to him, well, it's okay, I'm a member. I mean, I go to the school at Concordia. He's like, are you deaf? That's not what I asked you. I asked you who you are, why you are here, and what you want. Examination before giving. Wow, I think that there's enough for all in the Missouri Synod to repent on that issue. So in general, the Apology says, this whole matter, meaning, remember if you were Roman Catholic at the time, because you have to distinguish scholastically between the merit, condign merit and congruent merit, you know, how you're, there are different kinds of merits, right? There was the merit that God just gave as a gift, and then there was the merit that you had to work a little bit on, right? And Melanchthon says, you know, this whole thing is made up by idle men. They don't know how the forgiveness of sins happens. And by God's judgment and the terrors of conscience, how by God's judgment and the terrors of conscience, trust in works is driven out from us. Because you want to trust your works. The old Adam wants to trust his works. And this has to be driven out from us by terror of conscience and the forgiveness of sins. So, Melanchthon also says, spiritually inexperienced people despise this teaching, but God-fearing and anxious consciences find by experience that it brings the greatest consolation. Consciences cannot be set at rest through any works, only by faith, when they take the sure ground that for Christ's sake they have a gracious God. As Paul teaches, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This whole doctrine must be related to the conflict of terrified consciences, and it cannot be understood apart from that conflict. What we have going on in our church right now is people understanding justification in their heads, but not in the wrestling of their conscience. And if you understand it in your head, then you're going to end up an antinomian. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be able to, I mean, the old Adam, you know, what does the old Adam say? He says, God loves to forgive. I love to sin. Such a deal. You know, he's totally happy with that way of proceeding. And if that's where we're at, then you see why you can understand why Rome, that's what Rome heard us saying, which is why they reacted like they did. And also why then they said, you know, you Lutherans are just, you're preaching people right to hell. And Melanchthon's answer is, you don't understand what you're talking about, because what we're talking about is what happens in a conscience that is in crisis. And if there's not a conscience in crisis, this message isn't for it. Walther got this, right? You know, you don't go around proclaiming the doctrine of justification to a sinner who is secure in their sins. Why? Because they'll say, well, great. I'm happy to know that my sins are forgiven. Or, I like to say, I talked about get out of Lutheranism free card. I got my get out of hell free card right here. Mm-hmm. Been baptized. I'm going to go do whatever I want to do, but I don't have to worry because God's going to let me in. I've got the proof right here. You know, they don't see how the doctrine's to be used in the consoling of consciences.
I was confirmed, not baptized.
Confirmed, I'm sorry. Oh, what did I do? Yeah, I'm confirmed, dang it. Yeah, thank you. Behave yourself. This is Acts 15 and St. Peter's, you know, having cleansed their hearts by faith, good conscience, a sincere faith. And the only way to have this good conscience in this sad and fallen world is when you're in that crisis of conscience to cling to Jesus, absolutely perfect, unbroken, yes. Your yes, even though it's growing in, your yes, though it's growing day by day by faith, right? You still got a lot of no in your life. Where God says, this is what I want you to do, and you say, no, or wait, or later, or, right? I mean, you can't base your standing before him on the basis of your yes. But in Jesus, there is an unbroken yes to the will of the Father. From conception to death and resurrection, yes to the Father's will. And that's the only thing that can stand up against the terrors of conscience and the fear of God's judgment. So, given all of that, and the fact that you're not going to hear this teaching other places, if you've been around, it's just not there. You don't hear it that much among us either. But if you're going to hear it, it's going to be among us. So, given all that, does it not become apparent why Peepcorn could write to a fellow who'd been thinking about abandoning the Lutheran Church for another, as he called it, obedience. In those days, remember what the big temptation was? It was the Anglicans. No offense. but it was because then you could be like a Lutheran, but you could have the apostolic succession. And wouldn't that be kind of sweet? You know, so, you know, granted that we always known that there are Lutherans out there that have that elsewhere, but we don't have it. So it was like, And of course, since the Lambeth Conference, which number was that? I don't remember, where they said, you know, the Lambeth Quadrilateral, this is one of the cornerstones of the church itself. You need to have the succession. So what do you do with that as a Lutheran? Anyway, listen to Peepcorn's words. He says, I believe that you've acted wisely in not deserting the church of your baptism and confirmation for another obedience. In my experience, there is nothing in any other communion that is not implicit in the Church of the Augsburg Confession. Let me say that one more time. There is nothing to which any Christian can legitimately aspire in any other communion that is not implicit in the Church of the Augsburg Confession. If, at a particular time or in a particular place, that which he seeks is not explicit, it may be that God has called him at that time and place in order patiently to recover something that the Church of the Augsburg Confession has lost or neglected or overlooked. Let me counsel you, therefore, to stay where you are, faithfully to pray, to study, to witness, and to work for the restoration of a sacramental life in that church that, above all others, is capable of most fully utilizing it. In other words, he's saying, because we get what the sacraments are for, a Lutheran church without the weekly Eucharist doesn't make sense. Not because we got some kind of a law, but because this comfort to consciences ought not be denied anyone there who wants it on a given Sunday. Did you hear how it's the exact opposite of, well, this is how we do things in the Lutheran church. No, the concern was, how do you bring the comfort of Christ to bear when someone's struggling with their sin? Do you say, I'm sorry, come back next week? that's a very different approach than what we often hear going on. Now, oddly enough, somebody asked me about Nagel. Who was it? You asked me about who? Paul. Dr. Nagel once basically in that troubled Lenten tide, I'd avoided him. I love this man, and I'd avoided him because I did not want to hurt him. And I knew I was out. I'm on my way out, so I didn't even want to go talk to him. But my elders, Jeff Schwartz, made me promise that I would go talk to Nagel. And I wasn't impressed by his answers. I was not, because I shared with him my great concern about AC3, although it was beginning to crumble in my mind, and he wasn't even interested in talking about it. He just said, take whatever you've learned that's been faithful and true and use it to serve God where you are. That's all you need. I remember thinking, he doesn't understand. You know, the old guy is just not seeing reality here. Arrogant young rat, that's how I was. I was just, you know, convinced that it was useless to talk to him about it. But if there's something that's true, there's something that's the truth of God, it belongs to the Lutheran Church. Do you realize we're about the only church that cannibalizes right and left stuff from others to the same degree that we do? Do you know what I'm talking about? What we do in our liturgy? We don't even think twice about it, right? You do it in our hymns? Oh, Wesley wrote that hymn. Oh, I better not sing that. Wesley wrote it. That's not the question. The question is, does this hymn proclaim the truth of God? And if it proclaims the truth of God, we say, that's ours. Belongs to us. It's our stuff. And we do that, we literally do that. I mean, granted, in Lutheran history, this has never been an easy one, because there's also this, we got our Kirchenlieder, got our core hymns, and we're kind of jealous to make sure nothing is allowed to displace that stuff. What are the Kirchenlieder, the core hymns of most Lutheran congregations today? Dean and I were just talking, commiserating about whether we needed to take a cyanide pill when they asked one more time for how great thou art at a funeral. You know, I will tell you, I told Dean, I'm on a one-man campaign that the last hymn at every Lutheran funeral should be God's Own Child. And as you walk out of the church, you should be dancing down the aisle saying, death, you cannot in my gladness. I am baptized into Christ. When I die, I leave all sadness to inherit paradise. Though I lie in dust and ashes, faith's assurance brightly flashes. Baptism has the strength divine to make life immortal mine. There is nothing worth comparing to this lifelong comfort shore. Open-eyed, my grave is staring. Even there I'll rest secure. Though my flesh awaits its raising, still my soul continues praising. I am baptized into Christ. I'm a child of paradise. I submit to you that if number one, evangelism. Where's the place where your community comes into your churches unasked for, all of a sudden, boom, there? Funerals! And what do you do at a funeral? You sing stupid Methodist hymns. Sorry, I didn't mean that. But you know what I mean? Not the good Wesley stuff. I mean, you're singing Fanny Crosby and stuff like that. I mean, what a friend we have in Jesus, really? That's all that a Lutheran can find to say on the occasion of death? No. Let our hymns be so countercultural at this funeral. Can you, I mean, we had one of my best buddies at St. Paul's for many years, Charlie. Man, love this guy. He's one of these people that kind of, he walked with the bells, you know. He's happy. He was in the choir. He loved being in the choir. He loved to sing. And had a heart attack. He thinks he's got a cold, and he sits home and dies. And with his family, I remember the most awful night, telling his wife, telling his kids. And then it was Saturday night. It's like in the middle of the night. Early Sunday morning, I walk out for early service, and they're all there. And they said, well, we had to be with Dad today. We just couldn't stand not to be with Dad at the supper. That's the kind of family they are, right? So I tell Lola, the wife, I say, you don't get to plan anything for Charlie's funeral, because Charlie already did it. I've got all the emails to show you. I've got a proof. I mean, Cindy's going to sing this, and the congregation's going to sing this. I mean, we had it all lined out, right? We did throw in one thing Charlie hadn't requested, but that he loved. He loved the Hallelujah Chorus. So we got members from three or four churches together, and they belted out the Hallelujah Chorus, right? Charlie was a businessman who had connections in Chicago that were less than savory. He was an alcohol guy, if you know what I mean. So Vinny came down from Chicago to the funeral. And Vinny, I'll never forget it, because, you know, we knew who he was when he walked in, because it you kind of know, if you know what I mean? And he sits there, you know, he walks out. He's looking at us and he stares. I mean, we got tears streaming down our face. And he goes, I don't understand you all. It's like you're happy or something. We're like, we are. We'd given a witness because we didn't do any of those flimsy, useless songs. We took the promise of the resurrection and we threw it in death's face and said, you have not won. This man is baptized. This man belongs to Christ. He will be raised again. And if we listen real carefully, we can still hear him singing right now. And that kind of an approach is what I think we need in our churches. So pastors, I'm sorry, you've got to be mean and say to the people, we can do better than that when they ask for that. Okay, what I did was I would always compromise and say, well, you can do the one hymn. What was their favorite hymn? And that would be the nasty one in the middle of the service. But I made sure that we always began with the resurrection and we always end it with some sort of triumphant hope, really big. So how did I get there? Does anybody know how I got there? I don't remember. It's a favorite tangent. Poor Adrian's heard me go off on that more than once. Anything that belongs to anybody that's true is ours, right? Okay. So what on earth can begin to touch the peace that we can have when we know that we cannot discern our errors, when we know that we're honest, we can't even know the truth of our own confession, of our own heart. A Nagel quote that has remained lodged in my head for years and years, I didn't understand until this whole thing. He said, the only thing that makes a good work is that God forgives it. I thought, huh? But that's because in our best works, we got crud mixed in, right? You know, you do something stupendous, and as soon as you do, you're like, pretty good of me to have done that for that person, don't you think? You know, I mean, it crazes up inside. I mean, it's part of our life, which really brings us around to the horrible paragraph I began with. If you look the mess square in the face, is it worth staying a Lutheran? Given all the mess, I say absolutely yes. But not staying Lutheran and accepting the status quo. Staying Lutheran and the fact that you are church militant, and we have a battle on our hands, and it's not a battle of style or culture or anything like that. It's a battle of consoling troubled consciences, which is the one thing Satan does not want to have happen. Years ago, a friend of mine wrote on this. You guys heard Dr. Hein talk about this? Steve actually wrote the most compelling thing I've ever. I disagree with his assessment of the Orthodox on justification, you know that. But listen to the rest of this. I thought it was incredible. He called it going east. ? There's an important lesson to be learned when we hear of yet another faithful servant of the word vacating his ordination vow to join some heterodox communion. There is an unfortunate but familiar pilgrimage that entirely too many have taken, men who have offered strong confessional Lutheran service in the gospel, but who then have doctrinally gone astray. You guys love higher things?
You gotta speak up a little bit.
Sorry.
Okay.
I mean, too soft.
You're too loud.
Okay, I know. This is a complaint I get on the radio all the time. Yeah. All right, I'll try to be louder. You guys love higher things? Mm-hmm. Yeah? The heartbreak of higher things was Dan becoming a Catholic because he agreed with the Council of Trent on justification. But, you know, he's like the guy that dreamed this thing up from the base. And it's heartbreaking. It's absolutely heartbreaking. So we've had so many of them. How does this happen? When the chief article of justification, and I would say applying the chief article, not just knowing it, begins to wane in one's thinking as the chief article, when it becomes just one among all the other articles of faith, The devil can use whatever articles make up one's doctrinal passion, which are good in their own right, to replace it. Just because you're against the false teachers about whatever articles of faith are near and dear to you, that's no guarantee that the devil must throw up his hands and raise the white flag in seeking to separate you from a right faith and ministry in the righteousness of Christ. He's demonstrated ample ability to use your passions, your commitments against the false teachers, and your zeal to dethrone the significance of the forgiveness of sins in an all-sufficient cross of Christ. Once dethroning the sufficiency of the righteousness of Christ as the chief article, so he's not gotten rid of it, it's just no longer the center. Once that happens, he then works to drive a wedge between those articles of faith and issues of practice that stir your passions in the pure milk of the gospel. When other heterodox traditions hold your views about your passionate articles of faith, the devil will be at work to have you view their doctrinal errors as not so bad, even when they involve a false understanding of justification, the central article. So far, are you tracking with that? I mean, he is so right on this. In my own, I read this and I was like, dude, how did you get in my heart? How did you get in my mind? You know, because what's my passion? Take a guess what my passion is.
Worship. Liturgy.
Liturgy. Liturgy. And I'm in the Missouri Synod. You know what we have to, you know the sufferings, right? You know, it's bad. It's really bad. Those who have been around for a while have observed well how this played out over time with many champions of an inspired and inerrant Bible in the 1960s and 70s. Tragically, over time, many of these faithful confessors sold out the pure gospel in the name of a passion and zeal for evangelism and the mission of outreach. Let's get on with the mission of the church, was their cry.
Missionalism.
Missiolatry, as somebody once coined the term. And they believed that the Baptist Campus Crusade and church growth authorities had what was needed to successfully undertake the Great Commission. It would be so they could minimize their faulty understanding of that little matter of how sinners are justified before God. You know? I mean, stop and think about it. We adopted into our church a form of evangelism that was essentially Arminian in its approach to salvation. It assumed Arminianism. And I was trained in it. How many of you been EE people? You know, you went and knocked on the doors. You know how to do it. You know, you remember the questions, right? You know? And it was all designed on a basic Arminian approach. How the Presbyterians ended up Arminians, I do not know. It arose out of Coral Ridge. So anyway, in the midst of their narrow-minded passions, that is the church or ministry, the means of grace, the historic liturgy, these new people, a totally monergistic understanding of the saving work of Christ could be compromised for the sake of all the good that would happen for effectively saving souls. Now, that was the thought. That's only half of it. He adds, many who entered the ministry sometime after the Battle of the Bible and the compromise with Protestantism in the name of evangelistic mission, members of the next generation, these men were especially nourished to cherish the treasures of the church, its holy ministry, and its historic liturgy. And many, through the teaching they received, came to appreciate these articles and practices as confessional Lutheranism historically retained and expressed them. But I believe we are witnessing how the devil can use a passion for the Catholicity of the Church, its historic liturgy, and the holy office of the apostolic ministry to rend asunder the crown jewel of the Church, justification by grace alone, through faith alone. The devil can do it just as easily as he can use and pervert passions for an inerrant, fully authoritative Bible. The point is that Jesus makes about he who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me has application for those who would hold and cherish articles of faith in the gospel of our Lord. If we misorder the articles, if we cherish any article more than the chief work of the Savior on the cross and in the gospel, if we treat any other article of faith in our minds as the central article of the faith on which the church stands and falls, then we become vulnerable to a form of doctrinal idolatry that the devil can use to wrench the righteousness of Christ from us and our ministry to others. Good Lord, deliver us. So far, Dr. Hine. Does that ring with you guys? I hope that rings with you. This is absolutely crucial. And again, not justification as the chief article, as just an idea and a doctrine to put on the shelf. But the only thing that when you have a terrified conscience can give peace. And our job is to proclaim peace on earth and God's goodwill toward men. Well, I found that enormously helpful. We must beware like the plague being seduced into comparing an orthodox ideal with a Lutheran reality. Let me say that again. You get that? An orthodox ideal versus a Lutheran reality. How many of you guys have a kind of disappointing experience in the reality of the church? Do you think there are really any Orthodox who don't? So our friends become Antiochian because bishops are, after all, what the church really is. Bishops are the heart and core of it, you know. Got a bishop, you got everything guaranteed. And so the bishop who accepts them as their, you know, makes them, you know, wonder priests overnight, Bishop Mark, went to Oral Roberts University and was evangelical. And what happened to Bishop Mark? Oh, this council gets together in Antioch and the Holy Synod rules, or not in, in Damascus, and the Holy Synod rules that, well, you know what? None of those guys really are bishops. There really is only one bishop for the Antiochian Archdiocese, and that's the guy who's in charge of the entire Archdiocese. He's the man who's the real bishop. So they did this so that they could fire these guys. And they did. So our guys that became Orthodox to have a real bishop saw their bishop get canned really, really fast. And one of these guys said to me, this just cracks me up every time we think about it. He said, Whedon, if you stay, you will be the weird old uncle that they hide up in the attic and that they never let meet anybody. So when I got the call to the IC, I sinfully wrote and said, the weird old uncle has been invited to come down and have a place at the table. The point was, I really was convinced, as he was, that there was no hope for the LCMS, period, the end. There was no hope. And then all that weird stuff happened that who would have dreamed? And I was like, are you kidding me? And everything has sort of taken a brand new tact. Does she get rid of all her problems that way? Go visit around. You know not. But has the ship been turned? Is she turning? Well, I guess time will tell. But when you believed for sure that it was over, that the ship was sinking, it became an incredible moment when you realized, oh my goodness, maybe one of my elders, he said to me, back at the whole thing, he's telling him, there's no hope, and you know, I'm not staying, there is no hope. And he said, Pastor, your crystal ball is cracked. Pastor, your crystal ball is cracked. That wasn't Jeff, that was Doug. And he just laid it out there. He said, you know, you can't see the future. You do not know what's actually going to happen. You don't know. You know, have a little bit of humility. You do not know what's going to happen. I was like, Turns out the fellow was right. Not quite as dumb as I thought. Look, Krauth put it this way, and I think he's absolutely right. The Reformation is finished as to her doctrine, but barely begun as to her life. We've had if there's been one church that Satan's been gunning for centuries, it's us. I mean, has there been any other church that has been through the horrid upheaval? Stop and look at our history. I mean, Luther's brilliant idea of letting the princes become bishops. How well did that work? That screwed us up for the first couple hundred years, and we saw where that ended up. And then finally get to America, and you think, okay, there's a hope here. Maybe we could have a church that's not under the thumb of the government. Let's see what happens. And it didn't take us too many generations to fix that one, too. We've had a long history of big struggle. I would say to you, for the sake of consoling consciences, it is worth every bit of the pain, every bit of the grief. Do not fear. It's going to be hard, and there's never going to be an easy path for the Lutheran Church in this world, ever. Have no fear, little flock, because the Father has chosen to give you the kingdom, and you can take that to the bank on the day of judgment. Mm-hmm. Amen. I want to just wrap up with one more thing for you guys. Frequently, you will get Roman Catholics or Orthodox who will say to you, yeah, but where was your church before Luther? Jesus founded our church, right? they say it, and they believe it, they believe it. So I would like to just run by you a few I think that ship sinks on the basis of what these fathers, whose icons they venerate, actually said. Now, they tell me over and over again, Whedon, you're pulling their words out of context. We're going to put this up as a PD. Where did Michael go? PDF. There we go. So we're going to put this up as a PDF that you guys can actually download, have this at your disposal, read it. I put the references there for everyone. Go read it in its context, for heaven's sake. See what they say. Listen to some of this. You tell me what you think. John Chrysostom, on Sola Scriptura. Regarding the things I say, I should supply even the proofs, so that I will not seem to rely on my own opinions, but rather prove them with the Scripture, so that the matter will remain certain and steadfast. Sound Lutheran or Orthodox to you? What about this? Let the inspired Scriptures be our umpire, and the vote of truth will be given to those dogmas which are found to agree with the divine words. Lutheran or Orthodox? St. Gregory of Nyssa. We are not entitled to such license, of affirming whatever we please. We make the Holy Scriptures the rule and the measure of every tenet, and we necessarily fix our eyes on that and approve that alone, which may be made to harmonize with the intention of those writings. St. Gregory of Nyssa again. How about this one? What's the mark of a faithful soul? To be in these dispositions a full acceptance of the authority of the words of Scripture, not venturing to reject anything or make any additions. For all that is not of faith is sin, as the Apostle says, and faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So everything outside of the Holy Scriptures, not being of faith, is sin. St. Basil the Great. They love to quote St. Basil the Great on tradition, but they ignore what he says about Scripture. That's in the morals. What about this one? Concerning the divine and holy mysteries of the faith, not even a casual statement must be delivered without the Scriptures, nor must we be drawn aside by mere plausibility and artifices of speech. Even to me, this is a bishop talking, even to me, who tells you these things, do not give absolute credence unless you receive the proof of the things which I announce from the divine Scriptures. This salvation that we have depends not on ingenious reasoning, but on demonstration of the Holy Scriptures. St. Cyril of Jerusalem. Does this sound a little Lutheran to you? Huh? How about this one? This is my all-time favorite. The last one I'll do on Sola Scriptura. John Chrysostom again. By the way, he's the best. They're all good. He's the best. There comes a heathen, and he says, I want to be a Christian, but I don't know who to join. There's so much fighting and faction among you, so much confusion. Whose doctrine am I to choose? How shall we answer him? Each of you, he says, assert that I speak the truth. Well, no doubt, this is in our favor. For if we told you to be persuaded by arguments, you might well be perplexed. But if we bid you believe the Scriptures, and these are simple and true, well, the decision is easy for you. If any agree with the Scriptures, he's the Christian. If that's not Sola Scriptura, I don't know what is. Oh, and I just have to give you one or two on the fide. because this is where Luther was hammered. You added the word alone in Romans 3. Where did Luther get the alone? He didn't get it from Scripture directly. He took it from the tradition of those who had taught before him. How about this? Let us see, however, whether the brigand, this is the thief on the cross, gave evidence of effort and upright deeds and a good yield. Far from being able to claim even this, he made his way into paradise before the apostles with a mere word on the basis of faith alone. The intention being for you to learn that it's not so much a case of his sound values prevailing as the Lord's loving kindness being completely responsible. Well, what about when he says, you know the one from Ambrose, because that's in the Confessions. What about this one from Basil? Indeed, this is perfect and complete glorification of God when a person doesn't exalt in his own righteousness, but recognizing that he doesn't have true righteousness, is justified by faith alone in Christ. Or what about this one? They said that he who adhered to faith alone was cursed, but he, Paul, shows that he who adhered to faith alone is blessed. Chrysostom, homily on Galatians 3. He calls it their own righteousness, either because the law was no longer in force or because it was one of trouble and toil, but he calls this God's righteousness because it's from faith and because it comes entirely from the grace of God from above and because men are justified in this case not by labors, but by the gift of God. I mean, I could just go out. I mean, we're going to link to it so you can get it. And listen, I got it for grace alone too. Got it for original sin. What I'm trying to say is when the confessors wrote, the faith that we're handing on to you here in these books is just the faith of the ancient church. They weren't BSing you. They meant it. And they had the evidence at hand. Very, very easy to do. So I encourage you, patristics have been an area for me that I've absolutely loved. The more I read them, the more I am convinced that the real truth of the matter is that Lutherans have a correct read on what the fathers actually taught and practiced better than what we have in modern orthodoxy or certainly Roman Catholicism. I mean, with Roman Catholicism sort of cutting the, as Zasa said, they cut the balloon that was tethered to tradition, was tethered to Scripture until they can now make it up and declare it as infallible tradition. And, you know, you're not going to read in the ancient churches the dogma of Mary's immaculate conception or of her assumption. I mean, that's that, you know. You can find the idea that she didn't, I mean, the assumption that he took, that he raised her from the dead, but not the assumption that she was taken to heaven without experiencing death. Not there. Okay. Questions, thoughts, or comments? Something you were expecting to hear that you didn't hear, or expecting to be addressed that wasn't addressed. Yeah?
You were talking about examination.
Yes.
And we have, it kind of puzzled me, and I've passed for 7 years. Mm-hmm. So, the prayer of that you say prior to prepare yourself for communion in the hymnal, is that really examined? I guess I get confused about, does an examination need two people?
Yeah.
Instead of the self-examination, yeah. The card.
Self-examination is important. We need to do that too. But clearly the confessions are presupposing, they call it a human tradition, but it was a human tradition that they found very valuable. They call private absolution a human tradition. And they still say it would be a wicked thing for that human tradition to be taken out of the church. So the point of the examination is to allow the pastor time to actually determine the state of the person's conscience and to apply the comfort of Christ. It's not an inquisition into... you know, exploration of private sins or anything like that, but it's like, how are you doing? You know,
I guess what I see, you know, from my vantage, is I know you're concerned about us going so liturgical and such, that whole danger of going east, and I'm 14 years, you know, outlook on how they probably be in that place. I'm not there yet, or there. But what I see is more of a, still with the majority of the churches, why do we even need a pastor?
Oh yeah.
Why do we need him for this examination?
Yeah. What's the point?
That's more of where I'm coming from on that.
And I don't think anybody has addressed this better than the way Bender does in his wonderful catechesis, where he stresses, you know, the Lord gives you a pastor because he loves you. And, you know, and the point of the pastor is that he is there to truly, I mean, this is so huge for us. Do you realize where the idea of the visitation into the homes came from? Where did that come from? What's its origin? Pastors going into all the homes. It came from the Reformed. And the pastor's job was to go check up on how they were living. It was to check. So you hear these pastors talking to me. You hear, oh, a home-going pastor makes a church-going people. The idea behind that was something that the original Lutherans would not simply have understood. Because to them, the place where pastoral care took place was the confessional. You came to confession. You laid out the mess. The pastor spoke words of comfort to you from the sacred scriptures that built you up in the faith and furthered your life of repentance. And this is how pastoral care, I mean, Seelsorge, this is where it is what it is. So if you want to look at what we got right now, we have a Lutheran church that doesn't care for people. Let's be honest. We don't do the spiritual care of our people. And we've come to think of it as normal.
Because we found the evangelical model.
We found the evangelical model, which we found the people don't like too much, and we don't tend to do, right? I mean, pastor's coming. Better clean up. You know? We live in a culture right now that doesn't even seem to like people to enter their homes, right? If they're going to get together, they go out and get together. So, I mean, I'm not saying that's a good thing, but it certainly made even trying to do that Reformed way of doing it hugely problematic. But if we are serious about letting the confessions correct us, instead of justifying what we've always done in our lifetime and not being willing to look at what we're doing in the face and say, this needs correction, then we're going to move towards having a real operation of confession. And don't let us tell it. Don't let anybody, Peepcorn said, every effort to do it has failed. Wrong. Who's the man who did it? Corby. He made it happen. He didn't take it as simply being impossible. The man never knew what impossible meant. He said, well, this is what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to do it. And lo and behold, he had, you know, a congregation of people that actually practiced it. And all of a sudden, he became the great pastor that he was because he insisted that the pastoral care that accompanies the confession needs to take place. I mean, I really think it's an area that we need to repent on. Yeah.
Where did the communion exhortation start showing up?
The exhortation to communion is already there in Luther's 1526 German Mass and remained a constant feature in German. Remember when the Lutherans kept their Mass, they had Latin and German, and they oftentimes just, you know, mixed them together, right? But wherever you had the German service, so certainly in the villages, it was very normal that the exhortation to communion would be read. That remained sort of constant for the Lutherans throughout the 16th century. Then they kind of dropped away. And when they restored the liturgy with the common service, they actually had that in there because they knew that at the very beginning in the 16th century, it was common. So they put that back. And by the way, the one that we have on our hymnal is like, I don't know why that one made it in there. It's like, it's the worst one. It's the Brunswick one. I think that if you really want to read, you read Chemnitz, the third one by Chemnitz in the 1581 church order that he and Andrea worked on. No, it wasn't. I got that wrong. It's the 1569 order that he and Andrea worked on together. And the third exhortation is gold. I mean, it's gold. I one time used it in my parish, and I had so many people come up and say, we need to hear that more often. I mean, it was just beautiful. He did a beautiful job with it. It was very pray-y. It wasn't just like preaching at the people. It was prayer. But by the way, people ask, how come Luther's sermons didn't have what we call explicit gospel in them so many times? Well, because they always read the exhortation. And the exhortation is a very clear law, gospel, preaching that happened week by week. So I think you can see a big connection there.